We've got former major leaguer Chris Carpenter joining us, who not only spent time with the Cubs and the Bo Sox, but in the Nippon League. Take that microphone. Take that microphone.
Yes, I played over in Tokyo.
There you go.
Yeah. I was with the Tokyo Swallows, and like you guys were saying about...
But it was the Yakult Swallows.
Yakult Swallows, yeah. Tokyo Swallows. Tokyo Yakult Swallows.
Okay, I didn't realize that. Okay, I just knew...
Yes, Yakult was actually... If you go into, like, your local grocery store, Yakult is like a little probiotic drink. So they have, like...
Ooh.
Yeah, different merchandise that sponsor teams. And so Yakult was the sponsor of the Swallows.
Oh, all right. For all I knew, Yakult was a neighborhood or a region.
No, that's it. You could go get your Yakult probiotic drink.
There's a revelation. Okay, the biggest revelation, of course, is as word spread that Chris Carpenter had written The Long Shot, a children's book about a plucky horse. The first clarification had to be that, of course, that you're not the only Chris Carpenter that has had time spent in the majors. So that entered into the arena.
Some might say there's another Chris Carpenter out there that may have rivaled my career. And although he's a borderline Hall of Famer and two-time Cy Young winner, and I was a cup of coffee guy, he might have had a better career than me. But I will say a number of times, and more than I can even count, I was confused with the other Chris Carpenter.
Well, luckily your name's not Curt Schilling. First of all, you grew up in Ohio, and the minute I saw that, I immediately realized the horse. I was thinking to myself, what is his connection to racing? But everybody that grows up in Ohio, typically a little bit more harness related, it seems, than thoroughbred. But I assume you grew up and had an interest.
It's funny. I did not. So it's my wife is from Hot Springs, Arkansas. She grew up 3 miles
everything.
From Oaklawn, but she had no connection to horse racing, and it turns out we were there in 2021 on a little summer trip to go see her family at the lake. And they have good family friends who also have a home up here in Saratoga. Been into horse racing for a long time.
Which family? Family who?
The DeSalvo family.
Okay.
And so very close friends of ours. And we went over to their house, and I knew I kind of wanted to learn a little bit about horse racing and the horse racing industry.
Huh.
And find out they were part owners, minority owners of Animal Kingdom, a couple other horses that have done very well. And
through Team Valor.
Yes, through Team Valor. And it kind of showed me around and told me some stories. And it was the biggest thing that they will say is, the funniest story was, they just told me about how in the horse racing industry, go into it not expecting to win, go into it expecting to have fun and learn about the industry and be willing to learn and have fun, and don't expect to go into it and win. And so that's kind of what I took out of it. Steve would always tell me, if you get a horse to the gates, it's a win. If
yep.
it gets around the track, it's a win. And then, if it finishes the race, it's a win, and it's icing on the cake if it wins. And so that's kind of was the inspiration of this book with a long shot horse for our first race, and with no expectations of wanting it to win. Obviously, I wanted it to, but, when you're a long shot, you don't expect to win the race. And then to have it, come out on top was cool.
We'll talk about the book and the specifics in a second. The whole journey to become a children's book author, you went to Kent, right? You went to Kent State.
I went to Kent State, yes.
How did you even, what was the notion, the germination for a children's book? Where did that come from?
I asked me 3 years ago if I was going to be an author, and it was not in the cards. It was just something that, I'm not trying to be a Hemingway or Orwell or anything like that. I am kind of a sap when I get connected to things, and I had a good connection with this horse because it was... had a lot of similarities to my baseball career, kind of being a little bit of a underdog and having some injuries and things like that. And I just kind of saw myself a little bit in this horse, and I was very, very tied to it.
Yeah.
And I don't know. I mean, it all worked out.
What was the what gave you the idea to even to write?
I wrote a poem the night before the race.
Oh, jeez, this is
I wrote
great.
A poem. So, and I sent it to the mastermind behind Eclipse, Aaron Wellman. He's a very good friend of mine, and I respect him, and he has been, you know, the kind of the other knowledgeable part, and he's been nothing but open and welcoming to me and in the horse industry. And so I sent it to him, and it was just a short little poem, mentioned nothing about winning. It was just more of an appreciation for getting us to the racetrack. Because to get a 2-year-old at Saratoga, you know, it's not an easy feat to do. And, you know, we were just happy to get a horse here. And so he asked if he could send it out to the partnership group. And of course I said, yeah, but, you know, don't judge me on my poetry skills. So he sent it out to everybody, and, you know, lo and behold, the next day, you know, Ben Bang comes out and wins the race.
Well, and so that kind of leads us to the horse in question. And when, in fact, hold the book up, I'll take a picture so everybody can see right away. You'll see the familiar Eclipse Thoroughbred Partner colors.
Yep.
And a Reader's Favorite Award. Where's that from?
So I would send it in for reviews, and they gave it a 5-star review.
How sweet is that? Excellent.
Yeah, I put it on the cover.
Illustrations by Dave Papa.
And there's a cool story beside Dave, too. I met Dave in 2021. Dave is a street painter in Saratoga. And he
gets better and better.
He was out painting in 2021, and that was our first time coming to Saratoga, and we bought a couple paintings from him because we just loved his work. Told him that we had a horse running that day. I didn't go back and see him after the race, but the next year we came back and he remembered us, and I kind of had it in the back of my head that I wanted to ask him to be the illustrator, because what better person to illustrate the book about something cool that happened at Saratoga than a painter in Saratoga? And so he was very thankful and immediately took me up on the offer, and he's the illustrator of the book. So Dave Papa.
Oh, that's tremendous. This gets better and better. It's all happening here. There's Famous Amos striding across the quad. Ben Bang, and certainly we had plenty of conversations with Aaron and the team about Ben Bang during his career. Talk about, you know, putting this together and finding a publisher and you know, all the mechanics. And also, because Weir is close by, and you guys got a busy morning, 10 to 12, with the Thoroughbred Retirement Foundation's sort of media day interplay. So I want to get Kim on, too. But this is a fundraiser. It's gonna raise funds for, you know, for TRF. But the story itself, and let me pick up the long shot. Thank you. Give us the story. Oh my gosh, it's pretty. Oh my goodness.
Yeah. So I actually wrote it in the timing of Night Before Christmas. So love Christmas time, and the poem was originally written in the Night Before Christmas tempo.
Oh my God, this is cute.
And
wow.
Yeah, it was a passion project. My wife, I have to shout out my wife, Sarah, who was a huge part of this, has helped me through it's, you know, self-published. So with self-published, yes, you have an illustrator, you have people that help you edit, but you're doing a lot of the legwork. And so I can't even say that I did a lot of the legwork. She did most of the legwork. You know, it just all fell together, and we wanted to get it out for this meet, and we're working really hard to get it out by July, and you know, the team came together, and it was nice. There's actually a picture of John and on the next page where he was announcing the race, and I got approval from him, so I'd like to actually send him that.
Oh, how that's
painting.
Fabulous.
Yeah.
That is, Johnny will really appreciate that. In fact, we do have to catch up with Frank Miramati as well, who kicks off his Saratoga race calling tomorrow. This is just adorable. Oh my God, I don't want to read it. I don't know. Maybe we could. Do you want to read it?
Well, it's up to you. I mean, it's up to you.
It actually, I'm going to have you do that. If you do, you mind?
I don't mind.
And I'm sure you could almost do it by rote.
I could read it absolutely. Well, if you want me to.
Then we're going to have you do that because I think that's too much fun, and because I'm ridiculous this way.
Oh, that's funny. Okay, are you ready to go?
The Long Shot by Chris Carpenter.
Okay, 'twas the night before race day, and asleep in her stall was a beaut of a filly over 15 hands tall. The sun would soon rise on Saratoga's quaint stable. Our horse was the Long Shot. No one thought she was able. We lacked inspiration coming out of dark times. A two-year-old maiden would help with that climb. Joyful tears filled our eyes as she walked out the door. Today was the day we'd been training her for. Her task was quite tall. She was led to race 6. There were 15-1 odds and rain in the mix. Whether turf, mud, or dirt, it would not change a thing. She would race against odds and what nature might bring. As the bugler stepped up, calling horses to post, our Long Shot bay filly was forgotten by most. Our eyes fixed on horse 7, we heard a man call. All in the gate, it was the famed John Embriol. Our girl dashed from the gate and took a small lead. We overheard murmurs, "Long Shots don't succeed." The hair on our neck slowly started to rise as our girl led the field with that look in her eyes. Around the last turn to the stretch our girl came, with tears really flowing, we were screaming her name. One length became 2, then 3, and then 4. No one thought she was able, but she'd finished and more. At the line made official, our Long Shot had won. The rain was still pouring, but our girl had brought sun. We trusted a Long Shot despite what others would say, and could not have been prouder of our filly that day.
That's great.
Nice.
That is sweet. Just sweet as can be. Chris Carpenter joining us, former Red Sox and Chicago Cub and Yakult Swallow. And I did look up the career record.
Yeah,
you got that one win, that
Toronto. Thank you, Toronto. A little eighth inning comeback on that game.
So. Who got the run in that?
Goodness, I think it might have been Cody Ross with a line drive to left field, and we took the lead late in that game, and I snuck a win. But I still have the balls at my house, so
that's the beauty of it. I mean, and you know, everybody, that's the beauty of the Long Shot concept. You know, how long did it take you to get up? When did the Cubs bring you up?
It took me 3.5 years, and you know, I went through every level of the minor league, so I respect everything every minor leaguer has to go through, the hard work. And you know, you see these guys playing every night on ESPN and MLB Network, and you think it's easy for those guys to get out there, and it's a grind. And it's kind of the same thing as you see kind of horses get out here, and you know how much hard work really goes into getting them ready. Getting yourself ready to go out and play a game. So I was able to go up through the whole minor league system, all 7 levels, and finally made it to the big leagues in 2011.
3.5 of the years is not a because you came out of college.
Came out of college.
Drafted or undrafted?
I was drafted. I was actually drafted 3 times. I was drafted out of high school. I was drafted my third year at Kent State. I had redshirted my freshman year after an injury. I had Tommy John's surgery on my elbow. And then was drafted after my redshirt junior year by the Cubs in the 3rd round. And so took that opportunity and ran with it.
Unbelievable. Always in relief? Did you start as a
starter? No, I started as a starter.
Yeah.
And actually I went out to the Arizona Fall League and was pitching out there. And I threw really hard. I was a starter who could go out there and kind of air it out for an inning or 2 innings in the Arizona Fall League. And so while it's not uncommon anymore because pitchers are just throwing a million miles an hour now, I hit 100, 101, 102 out in the Arizona Fall League, and they immediately shut me down from being a starter and moved me to the bullpen and said, hey, come in late in the game and throw really hard.
There
so
you go.
That's what I did for the rest of my career.
So Peoria and
Daytona.
Yep.
And then went to Knoxville, Tennessee. To Des Moines, Iowa.
Yep, Des Moines is the
AAA. And then came up with the Cubs, and then, you know, spent some time in all the minor league levels with the Red Sox on that side, too, with Pawtucket and Greenville and, goodness, I had a number of different stops along that side, too.
Unbelievable. Two years and 2011
and 2012. Did you play Cape Cod when you were in college?
I did. I played. I was with the Chatham A's.
Chatham
it was still
A's.
The A's
I
at the time.
Hat.
I think it's
I
the
have
Anglers
a Chatham
now.
A's hat.
You should have brought it. You could have gotten it signed.
Yeah. Yeah, I was in Chatham. I loved the Cape League.
Cape
it was
League.
Great.
Cape League is cool. Wooden bats still?
Still wooden bats, I believe.
Right?
Yes.
Yeah. Yep. That's one of yeah. the one of
the only league I've ever played in where you have fog delays. Like you'd be late in the game and you'd have, you know, people out in the center field and they'd be lighting the field up with their headlights of their car and you'd have to wait for the fog to row through. But it was a fun time.
What was fun was you didn't know who the players were. They had like a typed sheet of paper. And it would say, you know, he went to Kent State and this. So you watch the game, you see really good talent. And then years later, I was looking at one and, oh, Evan Longoria was playing first base.
Exactly.
Yeah. You see all the stars out in the Cape.
Yeah. Now,
the minor leagues in general, as I moved around the country, and I lived in Cincinnati and Kansas City, so, you know, plenty of major league experience and you know, viewing and season ticket holding, but I was there for the Royals 85 championship, which was unbelievable.
Nice.
But when I got to Charlotte, got to see there's a ton of minor league baseball in the Carolinas, Carolina League, and at the time International League. I saw Bo Jackson playing for the Memphis Chicks.
Wow.
Saw him hit his first professional home run.
That is so cool.
Against the Charlotte O's. I also saw him do something, jump over a hurricane fence, catching a foul ball.
Wow.
Which is leaped over and I've still have the program. I'll never.
Yeah.
It's one of as many things as I've seen in professional sports, seeing Bo Jackson in the minors. And hit his first off Joe Kaharich. Kaharich, I think, who I think got to the majors for the Orioles. A lot of fun. Minor leagues are
great.
They are great, and what the sport's doing to them is kind of obscene. I mean, it's ridiculous.
It's tough for the players too, because you know you have so many guys that are probably able to compete at a major league level.
Yep.
They just maybe are. You know, have some all-stars in front of them that they get kind of roadblocked to get there. Yeah. And, you know, that's why I just have so much respect for all the guys that put in their time. And when you consolidate the minor leagues, it gets a little bit more difficult for those guys, those kind of lifer guys to hang around. But there's a lot of talent down there. And, you know, I just respect that grind those guys
have. The guy who manages the Atlanta Braves is a lifer. And
yes.
It's a great story, and they stuck by him, and now they're as a Met fan, keeping us from moving up. And they have a system. They stuck to their system. He worked his way up through the system. All these young players that play for him in the system. Then when his opportunity was there, they gave it to him instead of going with the big name. And thank God it's worked out.
Yeah,
you wish you would see it more. As a Met fan, we think we can sign a check and you know everything will be good.
Yeah. A lot to be said about you know growing and building that camaraderie of guys that come up through your system, and you know you play so much better when you're comfortable within the system.
From top to bottom, like my thing is, why don't you have the best pitching coaches, the best hitting coaches, the best field like Ron Washington. On the Braves, he does all these drills with the infielders. Well, you should be doing that with everybody and have more people like that developing your talent. Mm-hmm. You can't always buy talent. If you develop the talent, it's a lot less costly, and it has better meaning.
You mentioned the Paw Sox, and I tried that. Before I got Donnie Tal, the genius, the setting up the lines here and getting the place ready. Thanks to Donnie, does an amazing job. Before I directed my media interests toward racing, I tried to do some stringer work for Baseball America.
Okay,
with the minors, and I had an opportunity to go to Pawtucket. and for a couple of days, and they had, I wish I had these photos online, wrote a story about fledgling Braves, Richmond Braves, and now I'm going to forget his name, Leo Mazzone.
Leo Mazzone.
Pitching coach.
He was the pitching coach of Richmond at the time. And I've got a picture. Smoltz, Glavin. Who else was on that?
Maddox?
I don't think so. These were when they were coming up.
Gotcha.
With Richmond.
Okay. Yeah.
This is minor league. Yeah.
Yeah.
And he had this. You know, and before he joined. What was it? Who was the manager there when they had those good teams?
Bobby Cox.
Bobby Cox. Before they moved Leo up to, and the story ended up being about Mazzone, and because he was fascinating, and then he ends up being this fairly legendary major league pitching coach. Very very cool. I mean, he was straight out of, you want to talk about straight out of Central Casting. I mean, it's unbelievable. We're registering. I see. I got a response from one Lou Arellano. Lou got a big kick out of this. He's a Cubs fan. And yes, Dan Hart coming in. Steve Avery was the other youngster that was
got
on
it.
That
yep.
staff. Good job, Dan. And Chris Carpenter joining us, who's written the long shot. Kim, get up here too, because Lou's saying hello to you. I know you guys have got a full agenda today. No, you can. Yeah, just there you go. There you go. Pass that back and forth. Kim Weir and Kim, this is a delightful. We've now disseminated the story. Everybody's heard the rhyme, and hopefully this is a big hit and a big success on the fundraising front.
Well, we are so grateful, Steve, always for you to invite us to tell the story of our horses, but we are so, so especially grateful for Chris Carpenter for letting our horses take a place in his heart and to share the story of Ben Bang and to let the horses of the TRF kind of ride along, literally, with Chris and all of his friends on Ben Bang's back. He's carrying the message of our Thoroughbred Retirement Foundation to lots of folks, and we're so grateful, and it's a really fun way to start the day before the day, sitting here with you all, watching the track come to life. And so we will be together at 10 o'clock. Chris is going to sign some books and sell some books and talk to some friends and kick off our summer. This is our 40th year, Steve.
Yeah.
You will hear much more about that as we roll into the summer, but it's a great day.
How did this marriage come together?
Well, I always talk about the links in the chain, and we are so grateful for every single link, because any good chain is only as strong as its weakest link. And in this case, we had the strongest link connected Chris and I is a fabulous friend, Kelsey Marshall from Eclipse Thoroughbred Partners.
Okay.
So as Chris was telling you the story of how Keely and Steve DeSalvo told him about Animal Kingdom, and he said, I want to learn more. I want to get involved. Keely and Steve pointed him to Eclipse Thoroughbred Partners, which is such a great, great team and a great supporter of the TRF. And so as a result, Kelsey and Chris chatted about this when Chris, I think, told Kelsey the story. Chris, how did that actual conversation go?
That was a conversation with Kelsey, and I knew I wanted to give back to aftercare for these animals. It was very important to me. I look at my playing career, and I kind of just compare this very similarly to my career. And, you know, would I want somebody to take care of me after I spent, you know, 16, 17 years of my life devoted to baseball? And, you know, and to just cut it off at the end and have nobody care about you after you're done because, you know, you're...
That would be the NFL players.
Because you have no more value to them would be, you know, that would be heartbreaking. So it was very, very, you know, apparent to me that I needed to do something to give back to these wonderful animals and pointed in the direction of the TRF. And it was just, it was an easy link to fill in.
Tremendous. You're going on tour? Are you going to do all the appropriate... signings and visits, and
I'm very, very, very new to this. So I am going to be. We have a media event today at 10. I'm going to be at the track on Sunday.
Nice.
For the TRF quick call. I'll be sitting at the TRF booth, so anybody can come come see and talk to me, get a book at the race on Sunday. But other than that, I will say one thing. I did get to go to one of the TRF's second chance locations in Watery, the correctional facility in Watery, South Carolina. And it was really, really cool to see not only the horses, but see, you know, the impact that they're making on other lives beyond horses, you know, the inmates and how they go out there and how it can change the life of an inmate who maybe had no connection to horses before that. And then they see, you know, how beautiful the creature is and you know, get hooked on either the industry, or maybe it just changes their mental outlook and helps them when they get out of, you know, the correctional facility. So I think it's amazing what they're doing. It not only benefits the horses, but it benefits the inmates and everybody involved. It's a win-win.
For those who have never seen the Mustang, tremendous on this topic.
We are so I'm so grateful to Chris and his wife Sarah for going to Watery. You know, I Chris or Steve, you know, I'm constantly inviting people to go to prison with me. Lou Arellano has gone with me, by the way. He took me up on that invitation. And but it takes time and it takes a certain set of perspectives on the world to go and see it. And Chris and Sarah did that, and we're so grateful. But he is going to be with us throughout the summer. I should let you know, as his promo gal here, is that I know that Chris has a book signing with the Dark Horse / Impressions at some point in the summer. On Traverse Week. Very happy to say Chris and hopefully Sarah too, maybe the kids, will join us at our barbecue at the barn on August 22nd, which will be a very fun opportunity for folks to meet him and see the book. And I know that the Racing Museum is looking at putting an event together for him too. So we expect for Chris to be with us all summer long. And when, as Chris mentioned, on Sunday is our Quick Call Stakes race. It's a big day for the TRF. Our Quick Call beloved horse lived with us till he was 35. So we'll all be here in force, and we are going to have a booth for the TRF all summer long on Sundays. This is part of our Cheers to 40 Years, celebrating our 40th anniversary. So anyone who wants to learn about the TRF and Chris and the long shot can come find us over by the Taste of New York Pavilion. That's where our booth will be. And it's also online on our TRF website, the book for folks like my friend King Hackley, who's listening to us this morning, Steve. He wants to order the book. I just shot him the link from our website. So just go to the TRFinc.org and look into the shop. And the long shot is the first thing in our online shop today.
Outstanding. As part of the briefings today and the stories, Chandler Pavis?
Yes, Chandler Pavis. Oh my gosh, he is our youngest ambassador. That young man, I think he's maybe turning 13 sometime this summer. He has raised enough money to take care of a horse for an entire year in our herd, and he did that as part of his National Honor Society project. So he's going to be with us today. We're going to do a big check presentation and make Tyler know what an impact he made.
Well, that's exciting. Where's he from?
He is right here from Saratoga, is a huge fan of racing. That little kid would be a great guest for you one day,
there,
Steve.
Sure.
He loves it. Loves the sport from the get-go.
Well, since I'm already doing all of Seth Merrow's work. Sunday for the show, that might be fun.
Oh yeah. Oh, Sunday, he's lovely.
Loose on the lead. All right.
Oh, good. Okay. Well, I'll let Jim's Chandler's dad. They'll both be with us this morning, and we'll chat about that.
All right. And Ellen, you know what? We could actually do a whole.
The trio. He's in town. He's available.
All right.
Oh. Totally be remiss if I didn't mention one more thing. Sorry, Steve, but it is Saturday. We also have our Silks and Satins. The 5K is back after all these years. It's been on hiatus, and it's a fun 5K. It starts at the Fasig Tipton Sales Pavilion. It benefits the TRF. Of course, Chris is running in it. I'll be on the mic, doing this. And anyone who wants to stop by, we'd love to see folks for the Silks and Satins on Saturday.
Tom Law, you better get Tom.
Oh yeah, he's fast. He should be. All that Saratoga running crew needs to join us because it's back after many years, and it's the flattest course in town, so it's one for speed.
All right. Well, we'll test Law. I want him to go out and.
You want to put a wager on his time?
He's always talking trash about how athletic he is, and I'm always kidding him about it. Well, Kim Weir, as always, pleasure to get everybody up to speed. We had Brian Bouye yesterday, and we went through the museum activities, and he actually mentioned he included that you would be doing a function over there as well. And we will check in as the summer unfolds for everything that, you know, want to make sure for those that haven't been able to take advantage of the barbecue at the barn. We want to get them out in front of it so they don't get sold out, because it does sell out.
It does. And, it does. It's going to be a great summer, Steve. This is a wonderful way to kick it off. Thank you for having us both today.
It's my pleasure. Chris Carpenter.
Thank you so much.
He's got a...
Heck of a handshake?
No, he's got a
big paws.
Big paws.
Exactly. He's got a bear claw there. No wonder. And you got that tall, lanky frame. You know that big release that the ball's on top of people before they, right? give him the mic. There you go.
I said I definitely won't be a jockey.
No, your jockey days were yes. over at probably age six. That was about as close as you were going to get.
Yeah. Well, thank you guys so much for having me
Chris,
on. I really do appreciate
an
it.
An absolute pleasure. And my grandchildren will, thanks for that. And the grandchildren will, we'll read them that story repeatedly. I've already started to, we got Black Beauty. We got My Friend Flicka. We got, I'm accruing the horse books for the grandchildren.
Awesome. Well, thank you guys so
much. My pleasure. And we'll see you. So we're going to do you Sunday, too. We'll do this Sunday on Loose on the Lead. All
Perfect.
Right?
Take care, y'all.
Thank you. Chris Carpenter and Kim Weir as TRF. Thanks a lot. It's really fun.
Well, what's amazing is the illustrations take the whole page. So a lot of times you'll have type and then, you know, some drawing or something like that, but this is just for kids. This is so stimulative, you know. It just, and the words, you know,
the poem.
Words are good. Now, if he could get a beat behind this, you know, this could have a poem of meaning.
Turn into a song. Go up a song too.
Yeah,
look at you. You're producing. You're a producer. We got about 20 minutes to the top of the hour. I got a very tight window for today for. Sid, he's got a 10:30, and we've got a busy morning too. Beyond this.